Namaste. We have all heard the famous story of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. He is a classic case of dissociative personality disorder. The man himself doesn't know he behaves as two different persons during day and night, and one person doesn't know anything about the other person. Disassociative personality disorders are among the most enigmatic and esoteric of psychological disorders. And to discuss the subject today, we have with us psychoanalysis consultant, Mr. Himanshu Vaidya. Namaste.
Namaste.
Mr. Vaidya, can we start with what disassociative disorders are all about?
Disassociative disorders are essentially disorders of integration. There is a lack of integration in personality in various ways. One way is that there are two or three different personalities in the same person, which we call as multiple personality disorder, or the person may disassociate a particular part of his life. Some particular memory of his life is not accessible to him, which we call as disassociative amnesia. Or the person may feel that the world is not real, or he may feel that his thoughts and his feelings don't belong to him anymore. He feels detached from them. So these are various forms where disassociative disorder manifests itself. Essentially, it is a problem of integration where the person feels a part of himself is not integrated with the rest of him, and that part is felt separately. Mm-hmm. And this manifests itself in a variety of ways, either by a vertical split in the ego or in terms of repression of certain parts of the personality or events. So this is what the dissociative personality is all about, essentially a problem of integration.
All right. So like, are disassociative disorders same as multiple personality disorders?
This is a popular feeling, but actually it is not so. Multiple personality disorder, which in DSM-5 is now called as disassociative identity disorder, is only one of the particular type of many disassociative disorders. So what was popularly known as multiple personality disorder, now called as disassociative identity disorder, is only one particular type of disassociative disorders. There are many other forms of disassociative disorders also.
So that interests us further, like what disorders does this chapter cover?
This chapter covers quite a number of disassociative disorders, out of which four categories are very important from psychoanalytic point of view. Mm-hmm. First category is disassociative identity disorder, previously called as multiple personality disorder. In this disorder, we have two different parts of the personality not knowing about each other. As you had started the discussion by recalling the instance of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. During the daytime, he is Dr. Jekyll, a very noble doctor. And during the night, he is the serial killer, Hyde, Mr. Hyde. And the two of them don't know about each other. There is a kind of a vertical split in the ego. So just as we talk about horizontal split of repression, here you have a vertical split of disassociation. Mm-hmm. And this is one particular type of disorder. The usual manifestation of this disorder is there is one main personality and other subsidiary secondary personalities. Mm-hmm. The main personality is called the major, and the other personalities are called the alters. And we have documented case of a person with one main personality and 14 alters. Mm. 14 alters.
Oh God.
And you never know who is active at which time and which mister you are speaking to. Mm. Because the same person is Mr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, and you don't know how many other Misters. So you don't know which Mister you're talking to at a given moment.
Right.
This is one disorder the chapter deals with, dissociative identity disorder. The second disorder the chapter deals with is dissociative amnesia, where a particular part of memory is disassociated, or anything before a particular event is disassociated, or all events of particular type are disassociated. So there is a kind of amnesia, either of all the events before a time period, or particular type of events, or maybe one particular type of event.
Right.
And this amnesia is very circumscribed, or it can be starting from a time going back to a long time. This is called disassociative amnesia. Third category the chapter deals with is disorder called depersonalization, derealization. In depersonalization, the person feels as though his thoughts, his feelings, his body is not actually his. And in derealization, he feels as though the world around him is not real. And this, because it causes impairment, is called a disorder. Otherwise, this is also supposed to be a spiritual realization in many spiritual schools.
Like when we talk about out of the body experiences.
Yes. So it is like the spiritual schools will say that the soul is making the attachment to the body weaker and getting out of it slowly. That is where the depersonalization happens.
Okay.
That the soul is not fully identified with the body. It is getting autonomy of its own. So the spiritual schools will look at it very positively. So because it causes impairment, we call it a disorder. Otherwise, from a spiritual point of view, depersonalization and derealization can also be construed or interpreted as something of a spiritual experience rather than a clinical disorder. Fourth type is the mixed type, where you have a mixed manifestation of disassociation. Some features of disassociative identity, some features of amnesia, some features of depersonalization or derealization. That is a mixed kind of manifestation. It can be a mixture of any type. Second, the disassociation because of persuasion, that under duress, maybe under torture, or maybe under indoctrination by a particular ideology, you start feeling disassociated from certain parts of yourself, which is called disassociation because of persuasion. And you can also have disassociation by trance, where because of some trance experience, induced either by meditation, hypnotherapy, hallucinogens, or any other method, the trance leads to certain forms of disassociative experiences. So these are the four psychologically important disorders which this chapter talks about.
I guess, in fact, stress can also be one of the major contributors in today's lifestyle.
Yes, stress is also stress is also a criteria in the mixed type of disassociative disorders.
It's quite fascinating and interesting. And at the same time, it is like quite difficult to understand how a person would be feeling when they have lost the connection within or partially. So like when we connect to psychoanalysis, what is the psychoanalytic explanation of the causation of this dissociative disorders?
Psychoanalysis, we often talk about the horizontal split, the split between the conscious mind and the unconscious mind. But here we are talking about a vertical split in the ego, where multiple personalities, they live in the ego, right? And there is a strange kind of disassociation, which is repression in a way and repression not in a way. In a way, it is repression because One part does not know the other part. So that part which does not know the other part does experience a repression kind of phenomenon.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, it is not repression because it's coming out overtly in the other personality.
Mm-hmm.
So it is a vertical split and multiple people live in that split. Now, the causation is very unique to this disorder because of certain reasons. One, the trauma or the unbearable effect has to be of very high order for this disorder to occur.
Mm-hmm.
Two, this is very near to psychosis in a way, because like in psychosis, the world is too much with us. That is the feeling. The person cannot bear reality as it is. And in psychosis, just as you try to create a world of your own, in this disorder also you try to create a world of your own.
Mm-hmm.
But the world of your own is created in a far more rational and realistic way compared to psychosis.
Mm-hmm. Like it's not...
almost means that... Yeah, so there are no hallucinations, delusions like in psychosis. So the ego is strong enough to overcome the difficulties of psychosis, but the trauma is so much that the self and the world as they are unbearable.
Mm-hmm.
So if you cannot change the world, you have to change the self.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, a completely new personality is created in order to overcome certain fears or to satisfy certain desires. So this is a very interesting type where we look at the vertical split in the ego,
mm-hmm.
and multiple personalities being created.
Mm-hmm.
Another important point is this disorder also leads us to the fine distinction between ego strength and ego cohesion.
Mm-hmm.
In the sense, in this disorder, you don't see disintegration of the ego, but you do see the cracking of inside. It's almost as though the boundary is protected and all the stress is pushed inside, leading to a crack in the personality.
Mm-hmm.
In case of psychosis, the boundary is not protected. So there are holes in the boundary through which projective identification happens.
Right.
Things get projected out and then they are heard as delusions or hallucinations or something.
Mm.
Heard meaning seen as delusions or hallucinations. So you project out and then you fear that, you hear that or you see that. But essentially, if we assume boundary to be like a layer, in that layer holes are punched by the sheer stress of the trauma.
Mm-hmm.
And projection happens and then delusion and hallucination happens.
Mm-hmm.
In case of psychosis, you may also have too much of stress coming on the ego disintegrating, and therefore early life conflicts which were successfully repressed by the ego coming out.
Right.
Both the kind of mechanisms can be there. It can also be a mechanism of attack of rage or envy on one's cognitive apparatus. That can also be a way in psychosis. But here we see something different and very interesting in disassociation. There is buildup of stress. There is buildup of negative effect. There is unbearable negative effect there. And therefore something has to be done. The boundaries are very strong. So you cannot punch a hole in the boundary and do projection or projective identification. It appears as though the entire stress moves upwards and creates a crack, a vertical split in the ego.
Mm.
And therefore, this is the fundamental mechanism, it appears, although we don't know much about it, of the way causation happens. Now, why does this happen is the second part. That a creation of multiple personality, maybe because of wish fulfillment, maybe because of anxiety, maybe because of envy, maybe because of guilt and shame, maybe because of just something something else like leading multiple lives or something of that sort, which we don't really understand fully.
Even anger.
So these are some of, yeah, it can be anger. So these are the reasons why multiple personality disorder can happen. And the way it happens is by a vertical split in the ego and the boundaries being intact, the ego cohesion being intact. So there is no projection, no projective identification, no disintegration of the ego like in ordinary psychosis, no attack on the cognitive apparatus per se. Both the personalities are able to use the cognitive apparatus very well. So we don't see all the Bionian phenomena of envy attack or narcissistic rage attack on the cognitive apparatus. But we do see a vertical split in the ego and we see multiple lives being lived. So this is the mechanism of the vertical split of persona creation, of trying to create a world or trying to create a self, which is very strongly desired by the person. So the wish fulfillment, the avoidance of anxiety, envy, anger, and other negative effects, all of them go into this creation of the causation of the multiple personality disorder. And in general, with regard to disassociative amnesia, it is very clear that we are dealing with some traumatic event. And in order to block the effect of the traumatic event, the traumatic event is severely repressed. So the mechanism there is very simple of repression.
Right.
With regard to depersonalization and derealization, it's a slightly complicated situation. In depersonalization, there is a sort of disowning of the self. Because certain parts of the self appear unpleasant to oneself, far away from what one desired one to be.
So it can be abandonment of this.
Yeah, it's almost an abandonment of the self because the self is not good enough. Or at least certain parts of the self are not good enough. And similarly, derealization, it is like a panic reaction. There is a sudden rise of anxiety and a sudden rise of doubting of the world around. So that is more like a anxiety reaction. A more of a disowning reaction, a more of negating the world reaction, because the world is not what I want it to be.
Do you mean that it means it includes a lot of somatization?
Not exactly somatization, but it leads to a psychological phenomena very akin to it, where the working of the senses as it usually works is no longer working the same way and you start doubting it.
Okay.
There is almost like a movement of energy away from the senses into the pure observational part of the mind. And this is almost like a meditative condition where you start detaching yourself from the outer reality and you see it almost as ephemeral, not as something concrete and stable. So this is how the depersonalization and derealization we can partly understand. Alternative perspective to understand that would be that negative feelings of anger, guilt, pain, irritation, sadness are coming up, because of which signal anxiety is coming up, and signal anxiety is leading to depersonalization and derealization. That would be the ISTDP kind of thinking to explain this particular disorder.
All right. So how does psychoanalysis proceed with healing of dissociative identity disorders, amnesia?
We realize that essentially we are dealing with the problem of personality integration. So personality integration is not happening because of a very large amount of negative effect which is blocked in certain phenomena, certain events of life. And therefore, the central way out is to look at what is causing this disassociation. What is leading the ego or the psychic apparatus to put certain things away from one's normal consciousness?
Right.
And this means we revisit those events in his life where a huge amount of negative effect was generated, trauma was generated. Mm-hmm. And we allow the person to cognitively go over it, affectively go over it, feel the effect fully, and release it in catharsis. Because once this is done, and that event is detoned of its effect, all the effect is removed, then that event can be integrated back into the normal waking consciousness.
Right.
And there won't be any need for disassociation.
Mm. Okay?
So we try to overcome the need for disassociation by integration, and we do the integration by revisiting that event, going over it cognitively, effectively releasing the affective tone that is there, the effect which is there, we try to release by catharsis. And this we do using various tools. And one of the best ways to do it is to start with a cohesion psychotherapy approach.
Okay.
Because like in psychosis, the trauma here is very severe. The trauma is so severe that the person has to create a new person within himself. Or just disown a part of oneself. So like in fragile cases, in cases of disassociation also, it's better to start with a safe and slow cohesion psychotherapy. And only when the person is ready for interpretation, we try to do integration through interpretation.
Right.
And with the advent of video, it has become easier because now you can videotape the multiple personalities and show to the person. Otherwise, it would become very difficult for the person even to believe that what is being said about him is true. And denial would come in as a defense.
Mm.
He is not sure whether what we are talking about is having multiple personalities is actually true. But with video, it is becoming very easy to confront the person with almost a kind of a irresistible evidence in front of him. That the first part of acceptance, which is the first part of the therapeutic process, becomes much easier. And then I think once the first cohesion part is done, then we can go into what is causing the disassociation to happen. Is it the Oedipal phenomena? Is it the Kleinian phenomena? Is it the cohesion phenomena? What is it? And based upon this, we can then look at the second flavor of therapy to follow the cohesion approach.
That's quite interesting. Then we come to the holistic healing part of it. Holistic healing is something we hear today all the time. Is there a way holistic healing approach can help in healing disassociative disorders?
Yes, because this is not a new disorder. And all traditional approaches have done their best to heal this disorder for over centuries. Some have succeeded, some have not succeeded, some have partially succeeded. They have definitely left with some tools to us on this account.
Mm-hmm.
Let us see how we can do it. If we say this association is because of unbearable negative effect, then that unbearable negative effect can be reduced by Reiki or pranic healing.
Mm-hmm.
It can also be reduced in catharsis by psychodrama. It can also be taken care of partly by homeopathy. It can also be taken care of partly by some pranic healing exercises, some pranayama exercises.
Mm-hmm.
Especially the anulom vilom exercise in pranayama is essentially aimed at integration of the two parts of the personality.
Mm-hmm.
And many people with any form of disassociation, they generally report some sort of relief with this kind of yoga technique.
Mm-hmm.
In tantra, you have many exercises, particularly the exercises of Avishkar and the exercise of what they call, it's called Swapneshwari, but you can also have a male counterpart of it.
Okay.
Where using dreams, certain forms of integration are approached. How to do integration using dreams.
Mm-hmm.
So all these tools plus the tool of social support and peer groups, that can be very, very helpful in adding to the central psychotherapy approach which we use to heal this disorder. So of course there is a central approach of medication and psychotherapy.
Mm-hmm.
Medication, you can go for allopathic or homeopathic, and apart from it, these holistic healing tools definitely complement the healing process.
So how is patient education important in the context of this disorder? Does the person is aware of what is happening to him? Like, there's so many things, as you have mentioned, different type of disorders which come under. Are they aware of what is happening to them?
This is one of those disorders where patient education is extremely important, because legally the person is one.
Yeah.
Psychologically the person may be many, but legally he is one. And that one has to take the liability of everyone. Right? So if one alter goes and signs a check, the other alter cannot say the check has not been signed by me.
True.
So this disorder presents a very difficult real life situation.
Mm-hmm.
That when this person is dealing with somebody, who is dealing with somebody? Mm-hmm. Is he the main personality or is it an alter? So it's very necessary that psychoeducation takes place to make the person aware that if an alter of his is doing something, the liability will come on him, not to mention the social consequences.
Right.
And therefore, he has to plan out his days, or he has to keep somebody with him if he is in important decision-making position. And therefore, the acceptance is very clear, has to be very clear, that if an alter does something which is not right, when he comes back to his main, he should be able to go to that person and say, I'm sorry, I did this. It was not me, but something in me did it. I'm sorry for it. I have a problem of this sort. Because otherwise, it's very, very difficult to live with the consequences of this.
Mm.
Especially if the two personas are very different. Like one persona, if one persona is of a professor and the second persona is of a street smart dancer, the two are very, very different.
Nice.
So if the second intrudes into the first, it creates a very embarrassing situation. If one is a teenager and second is a very mature person, and in the company of mature person, if the teenager comes up, it creates a very embarrassing situation. So it all depends upon what is the nature of that alter, and how and when they come and how and when they go. So based upon this, he has to create a lifestyle. He may have to have some people around him to help him live as well as he can till the issue is resolved.
Mm.
Second is, once he is made aware, he can look at the precipitating factors and create his do's and don'ts so that the problem is minimized. Third, if he is well educated, he can know which therapy approaches or medication approaches are working, and based upon it, report it to the doctor so treatment can be accelerated.
Mm.
Fourth, he can create a set of holistic healing tools for himself, whatever helps, if he knows scientific basis of clearly empirically measuring the difficulty he is facing and seeing if any tool helps him or does not help him. And fifth, he can find out good social support groups who help him with empathy and not make fun of him or not take advantage of him or not persecute him in some way, being critical of him, so that he can have a more accepting, empathic support group. All this is possible if you do right psychoeducation, and therapy also is accelerated.
In fact, I'm reminded of so many Hollywood and Bollywood movies and novels based on this specific disorder. And people have slight idea of it, but when it comes to the family members and the caregivers, what should the family members of caregivers do if they are helping someone with this disorder?
First, they should realize that this is a deep-seated disorder. This is not a tantrum or a drama thrown up by somebody. Mm-hmm. And they are coming heavily on that person in a critical mode will not help the person, will not help them. It will only make matters worse. So there is no point in increasing the trauma to fight the trauma. So once you educate the family members on the deep causation of this, they realize that this is not something you can dominate a person and help him get over, or ask the person to use his willpower and get over, or give the person advice and get over. This is not something of that time. It's much deeper. Once they realize it, they stop doing the usual stuff of advising, criticizing, pouncing upon the person, mocking the person, making fun of him, and so on. And then they come to the deeper aspects of why it is happening. And they know how to behave with which personality. Mm-hmm. And which part of the other personality give the feedback to the main personality, which part not to give feedback.
Right.
Thirdly, they also know which therapy or medication is working or not working, so they can report appropriately to the doctor or therapist. Fifth, they also know which holistic healing tool is working or not working, so they can help the person get that holistic tool and accelerate his healing. And sixth, they can also find out or help the person find out some good social support groups which don't make fun of him, which don't persecute him, which don't take advantage of him, but help him. Right? And lastly, because of the stress of dealing with a family member with this disorder, they don't develop a secondary problem of secondary depression, secondary anxiety, and so on. Because they would always have an anxiety of what will any alter do and what liabilities will come on this man or the family.
And they have action of the triggers when the switches are happening.
Yeah. So the collateral damage in the form of secondary problems is avoided if family members are well educated and also given adequate support to look after this person.
So that's very important, because I think caretakers have a very major role out here when the person is totally not himself. He might forget his address also, or if he gets into some other role.
Right.
So that's very important.
Right.
Thank you, Mr. Himanshu Vaidya, for sharing knowledge with us. So we have covered today dissociative disorder. In the subsequent videos, we will be covering other disorders from DSM-5 in the same way. Do watch our coming videos and write to us at hvindia@gmail.com. Namaste.